Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome here. This session is called Financial Regulation That Might Have a Chance of Working, and I'll be chairing the session. My name is Bill White. Just by way of a few introductory comments, I mean, it's and at the risk maybe of repeating something I said this morning, we're still in the midst of the worst crisis since the 1930s. And I have little doubt that this thing is going to get worse still, in the sense that the problems that led us into it, of excessive credit, excessive debt, are now significantly worse now than they were in 2007. And if that's deleveraging, it's got a pretty funny sign. And as you look around, it seems to me that there's sort of problems everywhere. I mean, China is going to have a problem of transitioning to a consumption-led growth rate. The U.S. has got problems of productivity, participation rates. I think Abenomics in Japan could easily backfire. So there's just sort of problems out there that are continuing. And that leads you immediately, and I mean, we've been at it now for years, what's the basis of this? What caused it? What's sustaining it? And clearly, the financial sector has been sort of front and center here. I actually am not so sure that it should be, because I think this thing has got much broader macroeconomic roots that is really showing up now in terms of debts, both household debts and sovereign debts, rather than fragility within the banking system. But having said that, I mean, clearly you want a more stable financial system as opposed to a less stable financial system. I mean, that's pretty clear. And I guess in a way that's what this session is going to be on about, is the kind of regulation, better regulation for the financial sector that will make it more stable. But then you immediately get to the question of what do you mean by better? Two things strike me, and I've written a couple of papers on this recently. There's tens of thousands of pages of regulation now that have sort of come in, and with more to come, right, since 2007. I mean, literally thousands, tens of thousands of pages of regulation. But when you look at it, and I have to admit I've not read every page, it does strike you as sort of more of the same. You know, more capital, more liquidity, more supervisors, more detailed regulation. So that's one thing that sort of, you know, sticks in your mind. The second thing is that virtually all of the regulatory changes that people have been in the process of making, I know of at least one, if not many, really thoughtful people who think that those changes have no adequate analytical foundation. And that makes me feel a little edgy. So that leads you on to the question then of what do we mean by better regulation, a regulation that might have a chance of working? Do we need more radical approaches to all of this? And fortunately, we've got four excellent people on the panel today to talk about that. I'm going to introduce them in the order in which they will speak, which is the order that's in here. First, we'll have Professor Ed Cain from Boston College, then Gudrun Jonsson from the University of Iceland. Third will be John Kay from the Financial Times and many, many other things. And then lastly, Dr. Walter Todd from the American Institute of Economic Research. Each of them will speak maximum, I hope, 15 minutes. And then when we're finished with the presentations, we can turn to the audience for questions and whatever. And then we'll finish by going back to the panel again for final observations. So, with that as background, let me turn to our first speaker, Ed Cain, please. Ed?
Thank you, Bill. Okay, there we are. I want to thank the audience for coming to hear us, and thank INET for the opportunity and honor of being able to speak at this great conference. As Bill said, what we're really seeing is called financial reform, but it seems very much like trying to cure a hangover with hair of the dog. You know, we're taking a little stronger moonshine than we took before, but it's still going to have the same effect. Now, my talk is built around four cartoons. I am treating financial regulation basically as a cat and mouse game. The unfortunate thing about these cartoons is they're not funny. So let me give you the first one. That in ordinary cat and mouse games, the cat is the one that does the chasing, and that here we've got that the cat is very strong, and that poor regulator seems to believe that just wagging his finger, will keep the banks under control. And I think, and the cream is, of course, the subsidies that they want to extract from the safety net. And I'd say this is the pre-crisis situation. Wagging the finger was thought to be enough because these bankers were wonderfully marvelous, ethical people with great social things and so on. But that's where we were. Now, what we're carrying over, of course, is pretense, but we've changed the pretense. The regulators have been forced to acknowledge that the wagging finger isn't enough, so they're re-equipping themselves with small sticks that they call enhanced prudential regulation. But even these modest reform initiatives are being delayed, postponed, and lobbied down. So the main idea is to give them the power to fine corporations for misconduct rather than to deal with individuals, and the power to demand more capital against risk. But in the meantime, these giant U.S. and European institutions are using subsidiaries to help them lap up subsidies in ways that are making them bigger and more politically powerful than ever. Now, I warn you, this cartoon is offensive, the next one. It shows them lapping up at a trough the subsidies. You see Basel III is on a computer screen. It's being designed, but it isn't in place. And it says European bank, but that's very unfair. U.S. banks are definitely part of the problem. Anyway, it may well turn out that they're going to eat themselves to death, which some animals are actually instinctively trained to do. Now, so where do this trough full of subsidies come from? Well, from regulators' preference for no haircut policies of insolvency resolution. There's a preference among regulators. It's much simpler. You don't get the same amount of criticism. You don't get as many lawsuits and so on. So these policies actually coerce, and that's very important, unlimited implicit guarantees from taxpayers for mega institutions. This happens not because regulators want this, but because of two things: that giant firms are economically, politically, and administratively difficult to fail and unwind. It's just a headache they don't want to face. The politics will be terrible, the economics will be terrible, and the administrative, they don't have the skills really to fill in the positions that are needed to do that right. And the firms themselves take ruinous risks that in crises push the central banks into unwinnable games of chicken. Now, here I actually had found a film clip that I wanted to show of a head-on collision, which would have been very effective, but my secretary couldn't figure out how to put it in. But it was a dummy testing of cars and series of head-on collisions, and just getting the point as to what the central bankers fear. So the creditors of these firms believe they'll be paid off without haircuts, or with, at best, negligible haircuts, come hell or high water. And I say, how else could we, the default premium on Greek debt remain so low for so long? I mean, this seems to be merely theater that's playing out, and it's being played out for the benefit of countries like Ireland that have committed themselves to deals that they already regret and would demand something like a most favored nation clause. All right, now this post-crisis of games has several side games, and one of the major ones is a blame game that in the U.S., the Fed officials have come increasingly to blame the great financial crisis on ethical weaknesses in the executive cultures of mega banks, that is, these giant institutions that can command support. And they part of the pretense is that they pretend that their own agency's culture is not part of the problem. And to underscore this, I need to introduce the idea of a model of an organizational culture and go on to explain that the ethical weakness in the megabank's culture is sustained and intensified by payoffs they can gain from gaming weaknesses in executive subcultures at two other classes of firms. So these are all three interlinked in these problems. One is central banks and prudential regulatory agencies, yes, but also avoidance and advocacy intermediaries like Sullivan and Cromwell in the United States, and I'm sure you, in each every country there are law firms that are equally effective at this, and the promontory group, which is staffed by some of the top ex-government officials in the world and advertise themselves as able to actually help you get around regulation. So all three of these treat taxpayers as a herd of animals they can milk day in and day out. Now, to understand organizational culture, you have to also, I think, recognize that leaders of any firm or agency actually try to manage the reputation of their organization rather than the character of the organization. They fear bad publicity. They don't fear that as much as bad behavior in their firm. So what I'm arguing is ethically challenged organizations, which are basically almost 100% of the ones in the world, go through cycles of denial that start and end in the same place, which is stage one. I won't go through the other stages, but it is, what are you talking about? Our staff are good people, and they're doing great things. Now, and if it does come out there's some problems, then you know, make some adjustments and just try to get everybody off their back and get back to stage one. So what do we mean by a corporation or agency's character or culture? And Edgar Schein of MIT has a model that is very well accepted, the top model in sociology about this. And he says you can't understand an organizational culture without breaking down three components. The first is the espoused goals and strategies for achieving them. This is what people are talking about all the time. And secondly, the artifacts, that is things that are observable, the processes the organization uses and other observable features of its operations. So we have buildings, staff, equipment, technology, rules, for instance, like bank examinations, policy instruments, all of these are the artifacts. And then finally, you have deeply embedded behavioral norms and shared assumptions about how to behave in different circumstances. These unspoken and resilient norms and assumptions are what the French call le non-dit. These are the not said things. Nobody would ever say them, except in smoke-filled rooms of the agency or something. But they often conflict with the espoused goals. So agencies are just built around incentive conflict. So the next slide tries to clarify that. What are the focus of these regulatory norms? Well, what you hear about is that the prudential regulators want to protect society from the consequences of dangerous risk-taking, capital shortages, and loss concealment at mega banks. But there are two buts. That's where the conflicts come in. The first but is that mega banks are in what they would characterized as a gentlemanly war with foreign megabanks. And the politicians caution prudential regulators to be careful not to handicap clients in these battles. So what does that imply? Well, it implies the duty to be helpful. Second, the other but, regulators in the industry want a disclosure regime that to limit the possibility of runs and meltdowns, very good purpose, makes it hard for outsiders, even the regulators themselves, to observe adverse information in a timely fashion. So how does this feed into central bank self-image? Well, the first idea is this, and I think central bankers will agree with this, but maybe not. I say that they see themselves as a noble and unfairly scapegoated team of heroes who have been assigned overambitious goals by cynical politicians. This fits very much to the notion of the technocracy, that they think that if only they could just use economics, we would have no problems. I have a riddle I like to tell at this point, that what do you get when you mix gin and vermouth, you get a martini. So what do you get when you mix politics and economics? You get politics. That's all you get. So the thing to understand about these norms is that the extent to which staff members rise in the hierarchy depends on their ability to perceive and conform to a series of behavioral norms that are drilled into new employees. Now, my paper identifies five norms, and this is all based on my experience. I have worked at any number of regulatory agencies and central banks around the world even, and I think I've taken that these norms are part of every central bank. One is a mercantilist norm of clientele service to protect clientele earning power. You do not want the clients to go broke. All right. Second, there's a mercy and benefit of the doubt norm that dictates sympathy, help, and lenient discipline for distressed client firms and their creditors. That is, you hate to see them suffer. And loss concealment norms that, because of an ingrained fear of runs and meltdowns, demands that the regulators not only hold adverse client information confidential, but deliberately misrepresent this information when that is thought to be for the common good. That is, they say, oh, it's just a liquidity problem. And they won't even acknowledge that if there would be a problem of fire sale prices if they're forced to sell it, but the real value is still there. All right. And fourth, and this is, I defy anybody to argue with this one, performance standards that honor executives for not rocking the boat. That is one of the greatest things you can do in a central bank. And then finally, blame avoidance norms that urge staff members to protect the professional reputations of team leaders by not admitting mistakes even among themselves. Just, we didn't do anything wrong. What we did was pretty good. So patterns of crisis management in the last crisis confirm the strength of long-held assumptions about how regulators in advanced countries prefer to deal with distressed megabanks. First is a non-escalation norm. It says it's okay to mischaracterize the character of the firm's distress to prevent or stop a run or meltdown. So that gives them complete freedom to lie their ass off. And the second is a preference for completely rescuing the creditors of institutions that are difficult to unwind or sell off. Right. Now, my working hypothesis is that my five norms are part of the non-public character of bank regulatory cultures around the world, and no matter how much the artifacts of prudential regulation may be enhanced after a crisis, that is the weapons of controlling the cat, until these anti-egalitarian norms are confronted and modified, megabanks and their creditors will prepare themselves to play another expensive round of chicken with regulators in the next crisis. Now, what has convinced me of this is that we see people painting themselves as heroes for getting around the constraints that were on them the last time. The Federal Reserve figured out all these great new ways to rescue megabanks. Fine. And they tell us they made money for us, that their deals made money. And so all of this means the next guy that comes in or next woman that comes in, next woman that is in, will be motivated to repeat the behavior. So it's really irrational to reinforce behavior as they are without expecting to see it again. The whole theory of child rearing is that. You reinforce good behavior and punish bad behavior. So what kinds of reforms does that my line of thinking, if you like, lead? Well, it leads first to my next cartoon, which again is not funny. It is that the safety net is a criminalizable protection racket. They tell taxpayers that we will protect you. We will protect you as depositors and protect you as citizens from meltdowns and so on. But of course, to do that, we have to take money from you. It can't be done costlessly. But if we actually look at how it works, we've got gleeful megabanks that put a gun on the government a regulator who picks the pocket of a hapless taxpayer, dutifully picks a pocket. So if we want to rebalance incentives in government industry, legislatures really should recharacterize deliberate exploitation of the safety net not as inevitable moral hazard, but as a prosecutable form of theft. Theft is theft. This last crisis has taken a lot of money from ordinary taxpayers and have helped to keep megabank officials able to pay their yacht payments and huge mortgages and so on. So My idea is that the too big to fail or systemically important financial institutions have a funding structure that contains a coercive taxpayer put from expected crisis management policy, and that makes taxpayers into de facto minority equity investors because they provide loss-absorbing capital when no one in their right mind would voluntarily do it. And they do it on terms that no private party would even get near to. So once you think of this, that the part of the game is to misrepresent bailout payments, not as coming off the equity the taxpayers have in these firms, but that it's loans or insurance payments. Now, why are taxpayers' equity position inferior to ordinary shareholders? First, taxpayers cannot trade their positions away. Second, the downside liability is not contractually limited as it is in stock, but in fact, it's the upside gain that's limited. Because once the firm has recovered its losses, then it reaps all the gains to speak of. Taxpayer positions carry no procedure or disclosure or safeguards. No one is calculating this and telling us what our position is. No one is paying dividends on it. And they're not recognized legally as an equitable interest, which means you can't even have a class action lawsuit on behalf of taxpayers. Finally, managers further abuse taxpayers by blocking or delaying recovery and resolution. Well, again, I made this point about painting the leaders of all these institutions around the world as heroes reinforces the rescue propensity and the misrepresentation of the costs of the crisis are part of it. I just have two more slides to go. The next is another not funny cartoon. There's another side game. You have to ask yourself, why don't politicians and regulators equip themselves adequately? Why do they start with the wagging finger and now go, as I say, to hair of the dog? Well, the unfairness of the game is that megabanks can hide their moves, but they are allowed to observe and use consultation, lobbying, and lawsuits to constrain every move their regulator makes. So megabanks allow them to take home. We've portrayed the idea of the subsidies as cream. They allow the regulators to make a little bit of cheese for themselves in terms of industry approval and post-government earning opportunities. And as they go back to their hole with their cheese, they have to hold it up to the camera to make sure they're not taking too much. So they get a little bit of their share. And so what are the major takeaways, if I can just sum up? The first is that these artifacts of culture can change quickly, so it's easy to change the rules. And even that is not, I shouldn't say easy, it's easier, way easier. But the norms of a culture resist change fiercely. The favorable default risk premium for megabanks in Greece evidence creditors' continuing belief that bailout propensities are alive and well. Second, recognizing taxpayers' implicit equity stake implies that individual regulators, directors, and senior management owe fiduciary duties of competence, loyalty, and care to taxpayers. Now, taxpayers are not being treated as well as the official shareholders, the stockholders, and their money is being stolen from their pocket and transferred to the stockholders. And violating these fiduciary duties entails a criminal abuse of trust and may entail provable fraud, I think it does, promoting deceptive accounting so as to permit zombie institutions to exist. And these violations are a form of theft that should be punishable for individuals by criminal law. And so the theory of organizational culture that Professor Schein developed says that you can only change your predatory culture to a prudential culture by institutionalizing individual, not corporate, accountability and responsibility. So the corporate fines don't challenge these anti-egalitarian norms. They perpetuate what is truly a crime wave. But prosecuting and jailing bad Apple executives and regulators could create the kind of shock that's necessary to challenge these age-old norms and replace them with values that can better align assignments with ethics in the financial services industry. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And let's pass on now to Professor Gudrun Johnson.
Please.
15 minutes. 15 minutes, okay. I'll do my best. Do we have the slides up?
Yeah. Try the...
Try just push the green button and see.
Are the slides up?
Okay, well, the...
There
we are. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for attending, and also many thanks to the INET staff for the opportunity to contribute to this excellent event. To address the question placed before this session, I'd like to hone in on bankers' pay, draw some lessons from my home country, Iceland, into the limelight, and with the help from my highly skilled co-author, Jay Cullen, tell you about proposals on reforming bankers' pay that we truly believe will stand a chance of working in promoting financial stability. Now, I'm going to spend the 15 minutes talking a little bit about the executive compensation literature and what problems is faced with researchers in that field. Then I'm going to tell you about the astonishing consensus in the post-crisis testimony in this regards, regarding bankers' pay. I'm also going to go briefly. You hear me? Yeah. Briefly over the Icelandic experience and behaviors of what we have observed in regards to bankers' behavior. But the Icelandic case is by no means an exception. It's an extreme case, but it's symptomatic of wider problems for sure. And then I'm going to leave the meatiest bits to the very last, promoting bank stability through legal reforms to bankers' pay. Now, it's almost 40 years since Jensen and Macklin pointed out that separation of ownership and control for optimal contracting, aligning the incentives between management and shareholders. Although the success of this approach of Jensen and Macklin is evident, given the widespread use of incentive pay, the design of compensation systems in achieving it is open to question, particularly in the light of heightened dangers posed to the financial system by excessive risk-taking, identification problems in establishing a causal link between excessive risk-taking, between actions and performance, and the room to maneuver for bankers to meet targets set for them. Myriad of papers have been borne out that cover this topic, where incentive contracts are scrutinized for possible overshooting of sorts, where the managers have been pushed too far on the risk scale, taken on excessive risk through excessive leverage is one. And this is what researchers have been trying to figure out, whether there is indeed a link, empirical link, between performance and pay, whether incentive pay as such leads managers into temptations such as misreporting on the company's bottom line, simply to secure those bonuses. Researchers have also spotted patterns of managers conveniently disclosing information a time when their own related short-term assets can be optimized whilst putting long-term assets of shareholders or other market participants at risk. It is fair to say that research on the effects of incentive pay on management behavior is far from conclusive. Some researchers say yes to all these questions, some say no to all of them, and yet others say maybe. The reason why research in this field is inconclusive, let me just get to the next slide, is establishing this link between pay and performance is likely to lie in the complexity of this relationship or the relationships in question, but not least because of the measurement and identification problems that are particularly difficult to overcome given the level of confidentiality associated with employment contracts and lack of access to data. Namely, incentive pay structures at lower levels of organization are largely hidden. Bonuses are paid out on individual level, but the available measures of performance are at the aggregate level. In financial institutions in particular, bankers receive bonuses for shorter term, but they are being remunerated for something that needs to much longer much longer time to assess how successful was indeed at the end of the day. And in the case of the bankers, there certainly is room to manipulate financial outcome. And let me elaborate a little bit on that. International Forum of Independent Audit Regulators report on significant deficiencies in audit of 47% of public companies. So they report that the audit firms did not obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence to support its opinion. Audit failed to provide the level of assurance about the financial statements that it purported to do and that is required by professional standards. Mind you, people in the financial industry are not putting eggs in trays, right? Where you observe the egg falling onto the floor and the yolk sort of splitting up over all of the over the workers' trousers. Bankers are their performance is measured in financial terms, valuation of assets that certainly can vary over time and change dramatically with the tiniest change in discount factors. And this is exactly what they observed at the International Forum of Independent Auditors, namely that 60 out of 148 inspected financial institutions suffered from audit deficiencies in these categories. So loan losses, loan impairments, auditing of valuation of investments and securities. That's their business. Now, to that identification problem, pay is often endogenously decided. It depends on what type of house you have, what type of guests you attract. If you live in a palace in Paris, Angela Merkel or David Cameron might show up. But if you live in an apartment in Reykjavik, you may attract the likes of my mother. As a result, compensation arrangements are associated with a large number of, and I'm tricking them down here, with large number of observables and unobservable variables derived from both firm and employee characteristics. This makes it very difficult to interpret any observed correlation between executive pay and firm outcome as evidence of a causal relationship. CEO pay and firm performance may be correlated because compensation affects performance, because firm performance affects pay, or because an unobserved firm or CEO characteristics affect both variables. Irrespective of the differing views of the academics on the effect of incentive pay, those that were drafted to look into causes of the great financial crisis in as different countries as the US and Iceland are in alarming agreement in the words of the American Inquiry Commission on this point, which can easily be representative of all these inquiries. They all sound the same in this regard. Compensation systems designed in an environment of cheap money, intense competition and light regulation too often rewarded the quick deal, the short-term gain, without proper consideration of long-term consequences. Often those systems encourage the big bet, where the payoff on the upside could be huge and the downside limited. Now, I was a part of a team of technocrats looking into the causes and events leading up to the collapse of Icelandic banking sector. And Parliament handed over unprecedented allowances to the team to access and retrieve all data considered necessary to explain the events. I mean, we took everything in terms of financial transaction data, built a data warehouse, and did our analysis on it. And still, it was still hard to establish an undisputed link, causal link between pay and performance of the Icelandic banks, or rather causal between incentive pay, excessive risk-taking, and the eventual demise of the Icelandic banks. However, we did see that equity levels had been distorted in relations to inappropriate hedging of option awards towards employees already in the year 2000, before the banks had even been privatized. One third of all the reported equity in the banks was virtually fabricated. The SSE called it weak equity. I teach finance, I say equity is equity is equity. It was not equity. We also discovered that tunneling had occurred on a massive scale. More than half of the loan portfolios were in the form of zero coupons to holding companies. Astoundingly enough, the performance metrics calculated by the pre-crisis bankers determined that they did the best job ever the year the banks collapsed. Bonuses were largest for the first half of the year 2008. We also saw misreporting of profits and massive market manipulation of banks, of owned banks in the stock market. You can read all about this in my book, Bringing Down the Banking System, Lessons from Iceland. Now, what happened in Iceland was not invented in Iceland. I don't need to go through the evidences of the same in other countries and regions. But mind you, in most cases, banks were deemed well capitalized immediately before failure, indicating both overt manipulation and model failure. Now, so what did we do in Iceland after the crisis? The only ones in our society with less credibility than the politicians were the bankers. So politicians have used this political capital to actually implement meaningful reform on bankers' pay through regulation, and now a legislative bill is being discussed in Parliament to implement the CRD4. So simply, we put a cap on incentive pay at 25% of total pay, introduced clawbacks and payment deferral for 3 years. There was heightened oversight, whereas the Financial Supervisory Authority needs to approve all incentive schemes implemented at the banks. The main watchdogs within the organizations are also involved in reporting on what type of risk is associated with incentive pay. The board is heavily involved in setting up the schemes. And a mandatory metric was introduced. 35% of the bonus needs to be derived from the return on risk-weighted assets. I'll come back to the constructive ambiguity in a bit, but no bonus pay is allowed if no profit is turned. Although reforms have been made in this area, especially in Europe, Colin and I are somewhat underwhelmed by the achievements of the US regulator in this respect, and we go over that in our paper. But the two of the main challenges facing regulators in this area remain, firstly, to create a level playing field for employees of institutions which operate at the supranational or multi-jurisdictional level in what is now undoubtedly a global business sector. And secondly, to discourage a race to the bottom amongst regulatory jurisdictions hoping to attract banking business. Moreover, we shall argue that the dangers posed by inappropriate incentives have arguably not been eliminated, or at least sufficiently marginalized, by recent reforms to compensation, either in the EU or the US, and therefore we believe that further reform will be necessary if the stability of the financial system is to be safeguarded. Banks remain highly dependent on public guarantees, and that they are still too far too big to fail. The industry is even more concentrated than pre-2008, so further regulation of private incentives is warranted in the interest of financial stability. We argue that clawbacks on Mahler's account, and payment deferral should be placed in through the credit cycle. So 7 to 8 years. ROA should be a benchmark, not the ROE, since the manager doesn't have much jurisdiction over how much capital the bank should have. The regulator is the one to do that. It would be largely decided by the regulator. Introduction on constructive ambiguity to bankers' pay is warranted. So incentive pay metrics should change from 1 year to the next, depending on strategic vision of the board and the CEO, so that bankers can no longer learn how to game the system. They only have a year to do that, or less than that. Those responsible for any type of disciplining or oversight should not be part of any incentive schemes. Now, the underlying fragility of our system can not only be addressed by financial regulation, although we are to address that in this section. But, and this is food for thought for INET for next year's conference, for example, what type of changes are needed in the tax code to secure liberty, equality, and stability. And I introduced the cover girl of my book, and a product of the SIC effort in Iceland, which gives you the cause of the collapse of the Icelandic banks in one picture. These are ownership relationships of large enterprises in Iceland prior to the collapse. You can just imagine the interconnectedness that was building up in the system at the time. Why is this relevant? Because we need to address how we can reduce incentives to put on more and more debt on balance sheets, corporate as well as banks. And I am now going to allow myself to suggest a radical change to the tax system, or as food for thought, tax corporates at income level, just as we tax individuals. That way, the tax shield of corporates may disappear and the incentives to create complex business groups with endless special purpose vehicles and offshore companies in order to hide profits will probably disappear. This is also appropriate discussing this here at the OECD, where you can find the base erosion and profit shifting program already up and running. I also hope many of you will be able to join or continue this discussion in DC in May 5th and 6th, where INET and the IMF are joining forces with Anna Dadmati and others to discuss finance and society, where many of the greatest catalysts and thinkers in the field come together, including Elizabeth Warren, Janet Yellen, Christine Lagarde, Brooksley Bourne, Sarah Bloom Raskin, to name a few. Thank you so much.
Thank you as well, and doubly for staying just within your time. Excellent. Thirdly, John Kay, please.
John. If you doubted it before you came into this room, I think you will not be doubting now that regulation of financial services has been a policy disaster. It has been extensive and intrusive on the one hand, and yet captured by regulatory interests and ineffective at achieving its public policy goals. So it's obvious what we need to do about it, isn't it? The problem is we don't have enough of it. And that's why everyone has agreed that the right response to the crisis of 2008 is that the regulatory structures which were put in place should be intensified. Ed has already used the metaphor of the hair of the dog. The one I prefer is of the medieval sorcerer to whom you say when his magic doesn't work, or who says to you when his magic doesn't work, that is because you didn't believe in it enough. And that is a process which only ends when you drive the sorcerer out of town and look for other methods of achieving your objectives. And that's where I think we ought to be. I agree with most of what has been said so far, but I think we want to start in a more fundamental way. We ought to ask, what are the goals of financial regulation? We then ought to ask, why have we failed to achieve them? And then we need to try and learn from that how, in terms of the title of this session, we put in place a system of financial regulation that might have a chance of working. And I shall suggest, and I know this is a very radical suggestion, but one of the ways we might find a system that might have a chance of working is we might look at what has worked and what hasn't worked in other industries as well as financial services. One of the strange things about the regulatory debate in this area is it is as self-referential as the financial system is itself. That is, it judges itself by its own generated performance criteria. What are we trying to achieve in financial regulation? I'm going to emphasize, firstly, we're trying to achieve efficient capital allocation. Secondly, we're trying to secure financial stability. That means, basically, we're trying to ensure that instability generated within the financial sector does not have adverse effects on the non-financial economy. And thirdly, we're also concerned to stop fraud and quasi-fraud. For the financial sector, by its very nature, is something that attracts people who would like to accumulate for themselves large amounts of other people's money. and we need to try and put in place measures to prevent them from doing that. We need to do that not just to preserve an efficient financial sector, but we need to do it to avoid wider corruption in society. We should be concerned about capital allocation, about stability, and about goals of fraud and integrity. These are not the only things that should concern us about the financial system, but they're critical ones from the point of view of regulation. And what I want to argue this afternoon is that the mistakes in the way in which we've promoted capital allocation have created instability and promoted opportunities for fraud. We have two strands of financial regulation, one of which has been the focus of discussion so far this afternoon, which is what I call the deposit channel, which is regular, which is essentially taking short-term savings and channeling them into principally funding of house purchase and government, also to some extent other real estate, and the investment channel, which via securities markets promotes funds for business and also to some degree for real estate. We have the deposit channel and we have the investment channel, and we regulate the deposit channel via banking supervision and the investment channel through regulation of securities markets. And both of these have largely failed. And they both failed for essentially we could regulate these things by prescribing detailed rule books about the ways in which people ought to behave. And that policy has failed for the reasons which that, for essentially the reasons the Soviet Union failed. And that's the first lesson which we ought to learn from other activities and other industries. The centre simply cannot have either the information or the competence needed to implement that kind of process. And the attempt by the centre to do so leads to the kind of gaming that has been described, which in turn generates a more complicated set of targets, rules and regulations, which generates a further intensification of the same process. That, Hayek and von Mises explained to us a long time ago, was why central planning of this kind would not work, and they were right. And that, intriguingly, is basically the reason why financial services regulation has not worked. And that means, I think, we need to focus instead on different styles of regulation. That's what I mean by saying we ought to learn lessons from the regulation of other industries. And I'd emphasize three aspects of that. Firstly, the regulation we put in place should be targeted very clearly on specific final objectives, that is on the goals I've described of capital allocation, of financial stability, and of anti-fraud. Secondly, it should be concerned with the structure of industries and firms rather than with detailed rules about behaviour. And thirdly, it ought to be concerned with personal and corporate incentives. So we ought to understand the objectives, we ought to look at industry and firm structure, and we need to look at personal and corporate incentives. Banking regulation, I think, started to go badly wrong when a variety of factors, globalization, technology, ideology, changed what had previously been a history of informal supervision by a system in the 1980s that was increasingly bound by purportedly objective and universal rules. That generated gave a huge stimulus to the activity of regulatory arbitrage, which is a major contributor to the complexity which we see and which Gudrun described. Complexity wasn't solely the result of regulatory arbitrage, but regulatory arbitrage was a large part of it. And at the same time, this structure outsourced in large part the risk management of banks to regulators who lacked either the competence or the political authority actually to do it. In the investment channel, we've had since the establishment of the SEC in the 1930s, regulation based on a model which has focused essentially on monitoring the plumbing of public securities markets. In Europe, we've taken all this over in the self-referential way I've described, in which the focus of regulation is on the concerns of market participants and on issues of market right integrity, summarized in the famous European directives of MiFID and even better, MAD, the Market Abuse Directive. I would rather prefer to have a structure that didn't concern itself with market abuse, but concerned itself with customer abuse, perhaps CAD rather than MAD. No one noticed, as all this was happening, that essentially the traditional structure of public security markets had served its purpose. It came into being in the 19th century when we had railroads, railways, followed by breweries and automobile plants that needed to raise very large amounts of capital for large businesses in penny packets from private individuals, and to give these private individuals an opportunity for liquidity by trading their stakes in equity markets. Basically, as has been described already in this conference, large companies are not in need of capital anymore. Even new companies become cash generative at a very early stage of their operating life. The main need for capital in business is now for providing seed capital for newly established, for the operating losses of new established businesses. And paradoxically, stock markets are no longer a way of putting money into companies, but a way of getting money out from them. That is, securities markets no longer serve the purpose they once did, and our regulatory structure hasn't even noticed. As far as fragility is concerned, what I found really helpful has been the work of the organizational sociologist Charles Perrow on what he describes as normal accidents, looking at catastrophic failures in large systems like nuclear power stations, petrochemical plants, marine accidents and the like. And these catastrophic failures are typically attributed, he typically attributes, to a combination of interactive complexity and tight coupling. And what we have done in our financial system has been to dramatically increase interactive complexity. Gudrun illustrated that with her diagram. And at the same time to increase the tightness of coupling. So Lehman, the collapse of Lehman actually exemplified the issue. It was not an organization of any importance in terms of what the services it actually delivered, but it was a systemically important organization. It exemplified tight coupling in the sense that it was heavily dependent on overnight financing, so that it collapsed within the course essentially of a few days, and it was interactively complex in the sense that when it collapsed, it had more than 1 million contracts outstanding to other financial institutions which were uncertain of their value. That leads us on, I think, to some of the things I believe we need to do. Most of all, what we need is to remove this interactive complexity and the tight coupling, both of which are essentially unnecessary. That takes us back to short, simple chains of intermediation from depositors to users of the funds of banks, plain vanilla banks that do that kind of job, and a role for asset managers in channeling funds from savers into real estate and businesses. We don't need to have the whole variety of horizontal linkages that come from the huge variety of trading that has taken place, in which essentially the main activity of financial institutions is to trade with each other. When people ask me what do people on Wall Street or in the City of London do all day, the answer is they spend all day trading with each other. And that is something that does not need to be done. We need short, simple chains of intermediation. We need functional separation in the industry to prevent conflicts of interest. If you ask what the modern investment banks does, it engages in market making, securities issuance, corporate advisory services, asset management, and own account trading. And you just have to list these functions to realize that every one of them conflicts with every other. That takes us to saying that fiduciary standards of of behavior, the obligations of loyalty and prudence that go with the management of other people's money should extend right along the preferably rather shorter investment chain. It also takes me to a point which Ed, I think, made forcibly, and I would reinforce, which is we need to emphasize personal responsibility. That is, people who are in charge of larger and large organizations and take extraordinary remuneration and bonuses for being in charge of them are responsible for what goes on within these organizations. And it is not a defense to that charge of responsibility, or rather it should not be an offense to that charge to say that they did not know what was going on. It's only actually if we remove that kind of defense that we will be able to secure effective convictions of people in a way that will actually affect behavior. I've come to think of it as the shocked and appalled defense after Rebecca Brooks, the famous editor of the News of the World, who was shocked and appalled along with her colleagues to learn of the allegations that phones had been hacked during her time as editor of the World. We were all shocked and appalled, and not entirely by what had shocked and appalled Miss Brooks. And the same applies to what goes on in banks as well. It is extraordinary what we've allowed to happen in the absence of this kind of personal responsibility. Another industry which I've looked at the regulation of has been the regulation of London casinos. And it does seem to me extraordinary that if employees of a casino in London admitted to any of the kind of practices which banks in London have been guilty of, the people who were in charge of these businesses, as well as the employees of the businesses, would within days be banned for life from that industry. And the licenses of the casinos concerned would have to be transferred to other corporate entities. That our standards of banking regulation should be so much lower than our standards of casino regulation seems to me, at least first sight, surprising. And perhaps most radically of all, I think what we need is not more government intervention in the financial services sector, but a lot less. That means not just reforming the structure of regulation, it means getting out of the business of acting as lender of last resort, which when Badgett talked about it meant lending on unquestioned security to penal interest rates to lenders of undoubted solvency, and has come to mean lending on ropey security at concessionary interest rates to banks whose solvency is very uncertain indeed. We should get out of that. And indeed, we should ask questions about the role of monetary policy and whether manipulating credit markets is actually a good way of managing the policy, the economic policy of a modern economy. All of this sounds radical, and it is. And I think all of us understand the political obstacles which there are in putting place a more effective kind of regime. But if we don't do so, the unfocused public anger which exists about what has happened in the financial system will continue and will grow, and will grow to crisis point in the next financial crisis, which none of us can have any doubt we are going to have. We are, in that sense, playing a game for big stakes. And since everyone else has been advertising their books and other activities so far, I shall end on the note that if you want to learn more about what I've said and many related issues, you'll have an opportunity to do so in my book, Other People's Money, which will be published in Europe and the US in September of this year. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, John, particularly for reminding us, I won't say the only, but maybe one of the only good things about the Basel agreements is that they did note that there's sort of three strings to the bow. One of them is regulatory oversight, but the other two, which used to be the traditional ways of running things, is self-discipline and market discipline. And maybe we should be thinking a bit more, as John suggests, on putting more emphasis on things like that that might just work, rather than on regulatory stuff that doesn't look as if it is going to work. So let me turn to our final speaker, Walker Todd, please.
Thank you. Bon après-midi, messieurs et mesdames. Glad to be in Paris again after so many years. My talk is on financial regulation that really works, from Montesquieu to Ed Cain. And the motto that I would introduce, I took from a website of a former commodities trader, goes under the nom de plume Jesse, Jesse's Café Américain, and this is his motto. The banks must be restrained and the financial system reformed with balance restored to the economy before there can be any sustainable recovery. It should be self-evident, but official pressures in the places that matter, London, New York, Washington, Basel, such places, would tend to resist most of this proposition. And I have a cartoon drawing of Ben Bernanke, former chairman of the Federal Reserve, saying that some bankers and central bankers need more restraint than others. This one in particular took a balance sheet of about $950 billion in 2008 and transformed it miraculously into about $3.5 trillion before he left office in mid-year 2014. And his successor, Chairman Janet Yellen, has added another trillion to the balance sheet, so we now stand at $4.5 trillion on the Federal Reserve balance sheet, about five times what it was only 7 years ago. No industrial economy has tried that kind of an experiment in the post-World War II era. That rate of expansion of money. And there are, to be sure, consequences inevitably down the road for all that. In the short run, though, we in America, and I guess in Europe too, are living through what was once described to me as the demand for credit from the public is less than the supply, meaning all those reserves. And why should you then be surprised if interest rates go negative, at least at the short end of the yield curve? The price of money reflects low demand, high supply. This is a situation that might be cured, that could be cured in the intermediate term at least, but it hasn't been cured yet. Have we ever been in these kinds of situations before? Well, in France, the most notorious of these situations, central bank type money printing that got out of hand, was perhaps the first one. The John Law inspired Mississippi bubble, which came to fruition in the years 1719 to 1721. It's a drawing of John Law. I have seen a drawing of Ben Bernanke as John Law, but I could not find it for this exercise today. The Mississippi bubble episode essentially amounted to a great experiment in printing paper money backed by eventually stocks in a pure bubble company. It was sort of like the first technology bubble that we had about 15 years ago. Well, it went bust after a couple of years, and John Law had to flee France in disgrace. He was the financial advisor to the regent who was governing France at the time during the childhood of the new king. In any event, prices in France rose a great deal, and people incurred a lot of debt on the assumption that prices would continue to rise, so that they could always liquidate their assets at a favorable price and pay their debts. When the bubble crashed, many people were astonished to find themselves losing life, expected lifetime incomes, estates, both land and financial. And Montesquieu, then a young writer, wrote a book called Persian Letters about observations of a pretended minister of the Persian court and exchanging letters with his friends, minister from Turkey, observing what was going on in France at the time. And the gist of it was public mores in France have collapsed in the aftermath of this financial crisis. It is a troublesome event. In fact, it was many decades before French public credit was restored enough so that it was possible for most people to feel that there was some future in France for themselves and for their progeny. If you get Montesquieu's Persian Letters, which were published in 1721 in the immediate aftermath of the John Law Mississippi bubble, it's done as a number of letters, and letters number 128 to 146 deal specifically with this aftermath. This is Montesquieu. The English version in Wikipedia says about Montesquieu that, correctly in my view, he is famous for his articulation of the theory of separation of powers, which is implemented in many constitutions throughout the world, and he did more than any other author to secure the place of the word despotism in the political lexicon, from which we conclude that separation of powers, what did Montesquieu mean by that? Essentially, you don't give, in financial regulation, you don't give the king, the executive, the regent in that case, and his principal financial advisor, John Law, or might be the chairman of the Federal Reserve, you don't give the executive branch and the Federal Reserve the power to create money without limit. There have to be checks and balances against that somewhere. And in constitutions, you would implement a separation of powers to try to make sure that that takes place. Montesquieu in 1734 wrote another work that sort of reflected his view on the outlook for France at the time. It was Considerations on the Causes of the Greatness of the Ancient Romans and of Their Decline. And numerous factors are identified in that book that would lead you to think seriously about the way financial regulation is done today. Basically, the key lesson to take away is if you continue regulation the way it has been done in financial markets, you might want to bring back the ancient Roman office of the censor, who existed largely before about 200 BCE. The censor's duty was to watch the aristocracy for signs of pretensions to tyranny and to swiftly remove those aristocrats from both office and station in life. He could break them to plebeian status. The analogy I use here is it's as though every Bill Clinton had his own personal Kenneth Starr, pursuing him relentlessly and watching for signs of emerging tyranny. Well, after 200 BC, due to various political and economic changes in Rome, the rising tyrants, of course, wanted to get away, to do away with the office of the censor, and they did so. But you essentially need someone as your chief regulator who would think his duty with respect to the financial system is somewhat like the censor. If I see a banker who's crossing the lines, I want to get him out of office as soon as possible. And the theme we've heard here already this afternoon is something along the lines of where a plausible case of worthy of criminal prosecution can be made, then see to it that these fellows and ladies are criminally prosecuted. And finally, Montesquieu published a few years later in 1748, The Spirit of the Laws, where he elaborates on his theory of the separation of powers, among other things, and what ideal constitutions should look like. Every one of the educated American founding fathers read this book, either in French or in English. Every one. The noted American historian Henry Steele Commager, I think he used to teach at Amherst, said everyone should read Montesquieu. Half the Constitution is based on his writings. And I agree with it. After the Constitution was adopted in 1791, Treasury Secretary Alexander Hamilton, who personally favored unified powers concentrated in the hands of a single executive, the Rome of the Caesars, as to the opposed to the classical Rome that Montesquieu was describing, Hamilton persuaded Congress to enact and President Washington to approve a plan for a national bank. Hamilton's first Bank of the United States had the power to reward or punish other banks economically, but no official supervisory power over them. Supervision amounted to, if I feel like it, I'll clear your checks today. Or if I think you're a good bank, I'll avoid walking in at 1 o'clock and dumping a pile of paper money on your desk and demanding that you redeem it for gold and silver before the close of the banking business day. That was supervision in its earliest form. Generally, state chartered banks in the United States opposed the first and second banks. The second bank's charter died in 1836, in part because they resented these attempts at supervision by the second bank especially. The cartoon below shows President Andrew Jackson in 1836 resisting the second bank's attempt to preserve itself once its federal charter expired by getting a state charter from the state of Pennsylvania. The head of the bank was a man named Nicholas Biddle, and so Jackson is saying, "Old Nick, get away from me or I'll get a cut a stick and fly away to Araby." Old Nick in English, of course, is another name for the devil. So it's as though the second bank, the monster bank, is going to try to perpetuate itself. And then finally, relevant to our theme of where does banking regulation come from, what should be its objectives, this was mentioned last night, that in China, those who are in the know are reading Tocqueville's The Old Regime and the Revolution, which was published in 1856 in both French and English. Tocqueville did an extensive economic study of the causes of the revolution. Everyone, including the aristocrats, he concluded, agreed that some of the worst feudal abuses should end, things like the corvée and the taille, various forms of personal servitude or taxation that were considered very onerous. But when it came to petty feudal servitudes, the aristocrats insisted on the continuance of their rights and privileges, and the people generally resented those petty servitudes as much as or more than the corvée and the taille. A good analogy today would be bankers insist on light regulation, federal bailouts, and the like, while the public is deeply and increasingly resentful for them, even if, as the Treasury puts it, don't worry your pretty little heads, we actually make money for you with these bailout operations. The public essentially doesn't want to hear it. So that's sort of where we stand on financial regulation. The modern story begins in the United States with the coming of the National Bank Act in 1863, under the aegis of this man, Salmon P. Chase, who was, before going on the Supreme Court in the middle of the Civil War, he was Abraham Lincoln's Treasury Secretary, and it was his job to finance the Union during the Civil War. And Chase was a bit of an expert on banking law because he had been a Cincinnati attorney as a young man, and he compiled the first collection of the Ohio State Statutes in 1841. So he was familiar with Ohio banking law, and the Ohio banking law, in turn, had been based on New York banking laws that were enacted in 1838 in the aftermath of the financial panic of 1837. Those are the rudiments of American banking supervision, right there, those laws. And the national banking system that Chase created was the dominant system in the United States for a number of years after the Civil War, replaced eventually by the Federal Reserve System in 1913-1914. But the general thrust of the old national bank system was that there would be standard uniform bank examination. There would be periodic examinations on site by trained examiners who would not come in and dump a pile of paper money on your desk and demand redemption to see if you could pay up, but rather they would go over the books carefully and see if you were conducting your banking operations in a prudent manner. In later years, the powers of national banks were regulated under 12 U.S. Code, Section 24, Paragraph 7, and interpretations of the legal powers of a national bank written by the comptroller's staff became very important in determining what banks could do. A lot of this began to change in the 1970s and especially in the 1980s, as has already been noted, when the banks, I would explain it this way, based on also what we've heard on the panel here today, that in the 70s, a lot of commercial bankers essentially wanted to become investment bankers. Why? Because they wanted to be able to do the more exotic and interesting types of banking that they thought the investment bankers were doing, and to pay themselves the higher salaries that would be justified having delivered on the risks, that risk-reward ratio that they thought investment bankers were doing. The culmination of it all, by the way, turned out to be that Walter Wriston, the former head of Citibank, was the first banker to earn a stated salary of $1 million a year. The board of Citibank awarded him that in 1984, the year of his retirement, which, let us all please note, was after the 1982 financial crisis involving what we used to call third world debt. Not before that crisis. They gave it to him even after the crisis. And Wriston was, of course, the principal promoter of international lending by the New York banks at the time. Have there ever been good bank supervisors in the United States? There are two I can think of, and I think Ed Cain would agree with me on who they were. One was Bill Taylor, who was the head of supervision at the Federal Reserve Board in the 1980s. After the 1991 crisis, Taylor was asked to become the first head of the Resolution Trust Corporation, and he died, unfortunately, about a year after taking that job. But Representative Henry B. Gonzalez, the Texas Democrat who headed the House Banking Committee at the time during Taylor's term, in the obituary in the New York Times, said Mr. Taylor's death was a loss to the nation. Of all the regulators I've known during nearly 31 years on the committee, Bill Taylor stands out preeminently as the man who stood up to the most powerful political and financial forces in the country, never compromising his integrity. And the other regulator I would name would be Jesse Jones, the old head of the Reconstruction Finance Corporation from 1932 to 1945, who confronted a crisis as bad as or worse than our recent one in the 1930s and set in place the rules for how to deal with systemic banking crises that were followed in Sweden in 1992-93 and in Japan in 1998-99 for the reforms of their banking systems. They followed prescriptions laid out in Jones's book. But unfortunately, our chief regulators at the time didn't want to hear about Jones, but they were interested in hearing about what was going on in Sweden and Japan. It's just the way it is. After the Dodd-Frank Act, what has happened with regulation? Generally, it's protracted, it's grudging, as Ed Cain puts it. Even to this day, the big banks have failed to write acceptable living wills, which would avoid bailouts in theory and avoid their having to go to bankruptcy court. Ed Cain and I generally agree on what to do to reform this status of regulation. Generally, we would say prohibition, black and white rules, don't cross this line, is better than regulation, which is always going to be susceptible to political influence. And if you must have regulation as your choice, you want Bill Taylor. You want Jesse Jones. You want the censor. Nothing short of that is going to work.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you all very much. I guess the one thing that strikes me is I always sort of distinguish between three things to get good policies. I call them the should, the could, and the would problems. The should problem is at the sort of analytical level. You think it through, what should you do? The could problem is, do you have the powers to do what you should do? And the would problem is, do you have the will to do what you should and could do? And the thing that strikes me here is that there seems sort of a general agreement about the should part in terms of simplification, trying to deal with the complexity, the uncertainties associated with complexity. But we've got this real problem about the could and the would, some combination of lobbying by the banks, the culture of the regulatory agencies, somehow the public that it doesn't really see that they're being ripped off. What do we do to change the sort of the could and the should things, the could and the would elements of it, so that we can do what we should do? How do we go about doing that? I'm particularly struck in Europe too. I mean, if someone said to me, what's the biggest mistake that was made in Europe? It was to not make the banks pay the price right up front. And the answer is, and the difficulty is that, and this goes back to other sessions, it's not just sort of the bad economics that comes out of still weak banks. It's the fact that it's now been reframed, the losses, in terms of it's either the Greeks pay, the Greek worker pays, or the German taxpayer pays. And this has just driven a huge wedge in between these people, and we actually need bonds of trust if you're going to move forward in terms of all these unions and whatever. So this, I mean, I think it was John who said that these issues are really, really big, important issues. Okay, let's throw it open now. I'd like some questions, please, if I may. Paul?
Two things. One is,
Try to be fairly brief because we don't have so much time.
Sorry. I only implicitly was the question of regulation in skin in the game. Where, if you're going to have regulation, you have to have the people who are making these loans keep skin in the game. That has been avoided by what we call securitization. And we have to somehow have some regulatory system that says, after all, private loans are, or were at least, non-negotiable. The guy who made the loan had to hold it until it was either defaulted or paid off. Securitization has allowed the person who makes the loan to push it off to somebody else. That's probably the worst part of deregulation. The second part, which is only a minor point, is everybody says, well, we ought to put these people in jail, and that might do something. Let me just point out that we have the death penalty for murder. In the United States, that does not reduce murder rates very much, because we still allow people to have guns. I think the murder rate in the UK is much shorter. So you just giving a penalty for doing something wrong isn't sufficient. You have to prevent the instrument, them to get the instruments to be able to do it. And I think securitization is where regulation has to focus.
Yes.
And Ed? I'd let Ed go first.
The fraud that occurred in the representations and warranties, it's really a fraud problem. It's not that people have to be able to sell loans when they need a better opportunity. This seems like just a particular way of selling. But the fact that nobody has enforced individuals that flat out lied and brought fraud cases against them as individuals does affect things. You know, the thing about capital punishment, a lot of murders are out of passion and they're not going to be controlled. But there are murders that are out of calculation, and those can be controlled. It's too easy to say that capital punishment isn't a deterrent. It gets rid of some murderers, if nothing else.
Presuming, of course.
Modern securitization began in the early 1980s, and the attempt was to try to make a loan's value to a banker greater than, it would be the sum of all the parts, and that would have a value greater than the actual value of the loan. I would disagree in the sense of, I would limit severely the kinds of loans that could be securitized in the first place, and I would allow whole loans to be sold or transferred. But I think the modern form of tranches with risk layers, dividing up loans is about 8 out of 10 steps down the path to hell, frankly. So, and on corporations, death penalties, during the Occupy movement in New York, I saw a bumper sticker that said, "I won't believe that corporations are people until Texas executes one of them."
John, yes, please.
Yeah. And I think it came into it developed for two reasons, basically. One was that it enabled people to take profits on lending up front, which helped flatter corporate accounts, and even more importantly, helped generate apparent profits for purposes of bonuses. And secondly, it came into being, it grew rapidly because of regulatory arbitrage. And the amount of securitization that would exist in a world in which we didn't have these two issues would be extremely small. And once securitization did exist, the opportunity to take even larger profits up front by misleading people as to the true value of the loans or the package of the loans through bewildering complexity made the development of these markets all the more attractive. And that's not an argument for saying we need to ban securitization. It's an argument for saying we need to get back into a world in which the incentives to securitize are extremely small.
In a way, though, this is one of the talking about rolling back securitization, you might also want to ask the question when we start talking about structure here of rolling back all of the three big trends, which is globalization, securitization, and consolidation. Like all of these things, I think, obviously have some benefits, but they also clearly have some big costs. So I'm sorry, I have one here and then one at the back. Yes.
On securitization, we should do more homework, because it turns out that if you Google for the losses on subprimes, the losses on AAA tranches of subprimes were less than 2% of the subprimes. So they were worth AAA that they were given, and they were perfectly legitimate instruments. What was wrong was that the banks were allowed to hold those paper on 2% capital, which of course broke them. And this leads me to the compensation issue, that probably instead of trying to have regulatory interference with compensation policy, if you start by setting the right level of capital, you probably don't have return on equity pre-bonus that allows you to pay the sort of bonus that have been the issue. And this leads me to the third issue, and that is that when you compare a bank and a hedge fund, you discover that for the same risk-adjusted balance sheet, a hedge fund will end up having something between 4 and 6 times the equity that banks with Basel III will be regulated into having. So maybe the issue here is just to bring back responsibility to the system, and rather than try to regulate the bits and pieces.
So I'll respond to this. Level of capital, you say? So it actually is astonishing to see how big a profit the Icelandic banks are turning right now with extremely high capital and this constraint on compensation. To me,
high is 1/4 of what a hedge fund would have.
Yeah, well, they do have about 24% and north of that, the Icelandic banks currently. But to me, is that if we don't really understand the relationship of how incentive pay works, and we have the evidence that it doesn't work well, why do we need to have it? It seems like a big rent extraction to me. That bankers are set aside in this respect. And it's not doing any good, to be honest.
Okay, well, the thing that I was trying to emphasize, but I was also trying to finesse, is that banks have an equity structure unlike any other financial institution, that they have this taxpayer standby money that is equity. And as a result, they want as little of the stockholder equity because that gets a great return on the stock. But it, and that if we never, until we recognize legally the taxpayer's position as deserving of dividends and impose the same obligations that apply to ordinary stockholders, then, and I think that's very simple, and it doesn't really complicate the system. In the end, it just says we're recognizing we've got somebody who's never been paid. And as long as that person's not paid, there's every incentive to exploit that person.
But there's a simpler solution still, which is to take the taxpayer's equity away. And
I don't think we can take it away.
I don't think we will, but I think we can.
And of course, it's not just the regulatory side that's been acting as a safety net. We've seen the macroprudential side. I mean, as Walker suggested here, the macro side, particularly the use of interest rates, being used more and more aggressively to try to prevent the worst from happening. But unfortunately, I think we've substituted a lot of. We managed to get short run stability, but at the expense of long run instability. Please.
Absolutely.
And therefore, we're sort of, you know, and that's almost as big an elephant in the room as the regulatory problems, that we've got a massive level of private credit, but we just can't deal with the consequences of shrinking. And I don't know if you have any suggestions about how we take the air out of that. I mean, it's a messy problem.
Sorry, a comment in response, brief, and then I've got a question at the back there.
On the private credit issue, it has been dealt with on occasion historically, and there's a classic tale in Greek literature, the story of Solon of Athens. Read up on Solon. Who was he? What did he do? And why did he do it? You can actually shrink private credit, but you must make the creditors take a haircut with it. And that's the political problem that no one wants to confront. You can shrink private credit, but only at the expense of making the creditors take a bath also, which they will spend a lot of money to resist.
The Icelandic case also, we have had the perfect boom and bust cycle in Iceland, where we started with 100% of bank credit to the private sector in 1998-2000, up to 250-300% of GDP, depending on the statistics, and we're down again 2014 at the level 100% GDP. But of course, the creditors will have to take some of that loss.
Well, I'd just like to make the point that the losses are there. They're there. The credit doesn't even exist anymore. It's all about loss allocation. And the way that Bill posed it of saying how unfortunate it is that we're talking about the Greek citizens and the German taxpayers, because it's really the banks taking the write-down that is stopping us, and that's their political power, and that's the corruption of our system.
Make presentations to asset management groups and bankers and whatever. And I often say what you've just said, Ed. I say, the money's gone. Right? The money's gone. And the look on their faces, it just says everything, you know? And they will lobby in all sorts of different ways to make sure it doesn't happen. But the point is that if you don't have that regular taking of the credit losses, you just allow them to build up and build up. And then in the end, and that's where I fear we are, you've got a much worse problem than you would have had otherwise, and a problem with political manifestations, not just economic ones. That's the rub.
I mean, well, the man who says a Rembrandt is a fake doesn't do anyone any favor, not even the owners of genuine Rembrandt. Yeah. And that's the problem we
can't get around easily.
Yeah. At the back, please.
Some of the other, the question relates to the revolving door, and you've all kind of touched on it a little bit, but it seems to me it's at the core of the problem. And of course, what's said on one side is that you need private sector experience for government officials, and that may be due to the overcomplexity and the overregulation. And on the other hand, you need the private sector to have some knowledge of what's going on in the regulatory agencies, and it becomes this big game with these massive dollars, as Ed pointed out, maybe a bigger piece of cheese in the cartoon, of where they've got the inside knowledge, the inside phone numbers, the inside connections, both on the political, regulatory, and supervisory side. And I'm just wondering if you have any thoughts on how to mitigate kind of the downside of the revolving door, while maybe being able to get some of the upside on the revolving door.
I think the first thing is there are two sides to this, we can think of two different revolving doors. One that goes into corridors where people have been trained and they can go in the banking industry and they can do a better job. And the other is where they know how to make contacts and how to pressure and how to change the law against the taxpayers. And again, that comes back to culture. That in the Army is where we started to first lose this, where the people would go to the defense industry after they left and would do the contracting at really bad prices and would use their contacts. And I think the financial regulators have learned this. And there are, in my mind, some really disgraceful advisors. It's part of the problem that these people go off. And the worst offender, in my mind, is the Promontory Group. And somehow we have to come to grips with the fact that either you should have greater restrictions on what you can do after you leave office, or you have to change the culture so that people see that that's shameful activity.
that Janet Yellen's salary is 1% of Jamie Dimon's salary seems to me to say quite a lot.
Ed? It might not be a bad idea to have a regulatory training academy where you'd be essentially attempting, my analogy, to duplicate Annapolis as a training center for naval and marine officers. Because I think in the American military, you find that if you want somebody who really takes it to heart, who really lives and breathes the Constitution, it's a Marine Corps officer. And that's sort of what you want in senior regulators who would say, well, I don't care if you're Citibank and you're offering me $2.5 million a year to leave and come to work for you. I don't want to do it because I believe in what I'm doing and how I do it. You have to, it was sort of that way at the Fed when I worked there in the 70s, 80s in New York, and then it changed in the blandishments of the 80s with all the money sloshing around, but that is a goal that you ought to get back to. And remember what I said earlier also about the fundamental choice to make is prohibitions regarding banking on the one side versus regulating and allowing them to do whatever they want, but trying to regulate it on the other side. And the more you move away from black and white prohibitions and toward regulation, the greater the temptations and the increasing number of turns that revolving door is going to do.
Can I go? I have two.
Thanks. The question is to. Sorry. Was that you?
Sorry, I'm afraid I. Okay. Okay. You talked about needing a regulatory training academy. We have one. It's called an economics degree.
Yeah.
And the problem is that teaches economists that the ratio of private debt to income doesn't matter. But I think we wouldn't be having this conference if there wasn't an explosion in the ratio of private debt to GDP. So I think what we need is a way of limiting the leverage that can be allowed. And my feeling is have leverage to income limits and have them imposed and controlled by judges rather than regulators. Because a lot of what you've been saying quite succinctly is regulation won't work. But I've never seen a judge that can be bought out the way a regulator can. What about using...
Well, I don't think you've seen many judges.
I said the same way, not feasible.
There's a tale in American banking about Michaelis and Dona, who ran the old Franklin National Bank into the ground in the 1970s. He was an Italian who was suspected of having ties to the mafia, the Vatican Bank, and all that. And when he was in jail, he was interviewed by Nick Toschi, an investigative reporter. I think the title of the book is Power on Earth, the Michaelis and Dona story. And Sedona said, the thing that amazed me when I came to the United States was for how little a price you could buy a federal judge. I can buy one for $10,000. In Italy, such a thing cannot be done for less than $100,000.
Okay, I'm...
Talking to the executives of the two Irish banks who weren't the Irish Anglo-Irish Bank and asking them, what was going on? Why did they make property loans? Their answer was, we were under huge pressure from our non-executive directors, and they were saying the investors, the shareholders, wanted to see us booking more loans like that wonderful Anglo-Irish bank that was booking big profits on them. Is there a stronger role for non-executives to curtail rather than to encourage the activities that led to downfall in Ireland?
I did serve on for biggest pension fund for professors in the United States, and I was on the loan committee, and we were making two kinds of loans back in the late 70s in what I thought was two great amounts. One was on boxcars, and the other was on hotel rooms in New York, And I did get to ask them to just calculate how much was going out altogether and what would be the gestation period. And we avoided some tremendous losses in those areas just by an outsider asking this question. And yes, I think outsiders, but you have to have informed outsiders, and I think you have to have them feel a responsibility. I mean, I felt a responsibility to all my friends who were teaching in different schools.
From my experience as non-executive director of a bank, I would say do not put much faith in that particular mechanism.
Well, I have to reveal my true identity. Therefore, I'm a vice chairman of Irian Bank, serving as a non-executive director. But I mean, a lot of the efforts that we have been emphasizing or putting into the rebuilding of the of this particular bank is namely to create the culture that we want to for a sustainable bank. But on top of that, the politicians introduced a notion in the law on financial institutions or financial undertakings in Iceland, namely that the law was geared towards or had the mission of securing that these financial institutions are run in favor or in the interests of customers, shareholders, and the society at large. So there is a message from the legislator to the board of directors that when we do make business judgments or judgment calls, we have to take that into account. But it's not like it's at the top of the list, I have to admit.
I think actually, ladies and gentlemen, we'd better call it a day. As I say, the conference organizers wanted me to finish this at 4:15, and we've gone well over. So let me just thank the panelists. And thank the audience, and all I take away is that we have problems here with human nature, we have problems with the cultures that we have allowed to develop, and it's going to be a big task to turn it around. So thank you all very much.